All right, everybody, Peter here. The Time Worm experiment was a success, and we've got a lot of nifty new writers with a bunch of fresh ideas waiting in the wings. This is really exciting. We get to decide what direction this franchise takes. We're in charge of Doctor Who now. We're the Wait, what's that noise?
Guess who just got back today? That wild-eyed voice that had been away. Haven't changed, had much to say. But man, I still think them cats are great. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. Told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town.
So the Time Worm saga was a success. Not like a huge record-shattering blockbuster success, but it exceeded sales forecasts and it got generally good word of mouth, though the sexual content in John Peel's Time Worm Genesis caused a bit of a stir. British tabloid News of the World printed a story on the book and included a nude photo of Sylvester McCoy, taken from a stage play he was doing at the time. You know, American tabloids are pretty shit, but we've got nothing on the Brits in that area. Despite that shoddy piece of journalism, the Virgin New Adventures made bank and was ready to take the next step. So, fun fact, the Time Worm saga was meant to be a one and done. They were only going to do one of these miniseries, see if the Virgin New Adventures would sell, and continue on with standalone books. But then Marc Platt approached Darvell Evans with a story called Cat's Cradle. Now that title might not have flown on its own, since there's a Kurt Vonnegut novel by the same name, but Darvell Evans liked the title so much that he decided to do another miniseries just so he could have three books called Cat's Cradle. Cat's Cradle wasn't even remotely like Time Worm, though. Time Worm was four stories connected by a reoccurring villain. It was designed to be so from the beginning. This Cat's Cradle thing was so last minute that Marc Platt, Andrew Cartmel, and Andrew Hunt really struggled to find a way to connect each other's works. And while some of these books are stronger than some of the books in Time Worm, as a miniseries, Cat's Cradle was the weaker of the two. You know what? I haven't talked about the cover art yet. The covers for the Time Worm series were done by Andrew Skilliter, who'd been doing cover art for the Target novelization since 1979, as well as art for pretty much everything else. Chances are that if you had any kind of Doctor Who knick-knack during the 1980s, Andrew Skilliter did the art for it. He did art for posters, calendars, bookmarks, tins, the spine illustrations on the Key of Time VHS set, as well as the mural for the side of a trailer used in a 1986 Doctor Who traveling exhibition in the United States. He's kind of an unsung presence in developing the visual identity of Doctor Who in the 1980s. That material kind of dried up for him in the 90s. He only did one more Virgin New Adventure after Time Worm. A book of his art was published by Virgin in 1996, and that's more or less the end of his official involvement in Doctor Who until 2014, where he contributed art for a Doctor Who reference book called Who's Who of Doctor Who, which you can buy in Flexibound. What's Flexibound? I don't know. He still does tons of artwork, including unofficial Doctor Who work. He started a mixed media project called Doxy Diva not too long ago, and he has an Etsy shop, so hey, that's cool. Glad to see someone still doing what they love nearly 40 years later. For the Cat's Cradle trilogy, the cover art baton was passed on to Peter Elson, who would wind up doing 15 covers for the line. He started doing science fiction art in the late 70s, including art for the Terran Trade Authority series, published between 1978 and 1980. His artwork during this period was a major influence on the 1999 PC game Homeworld, and there's even a character named after him in the game. Sadly, he died of a heart attack in 1998 at the age of 51. The main difference between the two artists lay in composition. Andrew Skilliter's covers tend to pull in close to an element of the scene, either a character or an arm. So you're really only getting a sense of a scene, sensing the danger our protagonists find themselves in. The only real exception to that is the cover of Time Worm Revelation. Peter Elson preferred to frame the entire scene. Characters stayed almost exclusively in the midground, oftentimes with a threat approaching from the background. You got a real sense of moment and action. I don't think either are better or worse than the others, they're just different ways of communicating content. So our book opens in modern-day London. Modern-day is in the early 90s. Ace and the Doctor are hanging out at a cafe. Ace is trying to introduce the Doctor to the culinary masterpiece that is the Baked Alaska, when things start to go screwy. Time seems to be slowing down, the sky is turning orange, and a mysterious silver cat watches them from across the street. Nobody else seems to notice, which means this is some kind of projected message for our two heroes. They make a run back to the TARDIS, which the Doctor realizes has been invaded by some kind of alien presence, and the TARDIS door vanishes for a time, long enough for the Doctor and Ace to get harassed by a couple police officers. The WPC study the walls and peeling blue paint at the police box, walking around it just as Ace had done. She looked increasingly puzzled. "It's working on them too," Ace whispered. "They can't see the door either." She squeezed the Doctor's shoulder in a sort of comforted excitement. "It's some sort of joke, isn't it?" said the WPC. "Where did you find it? In a museum?" The Doctor looked up with a vexed expression. "That's my TARDIS you're talking about." His irritation had imposed a fresh vigor. "I mean, technically, yes, I stole it from a museum, but show some respect." Eventually, a door does appear and our heroes slip inside, but the TARDIS is buckling and rattling from invasion. Something is creeping about the space between the TARDIS's external shell and its infinite innards, an idea that might be a bit lost on people who are exclusively New Who viewers because they do the TARDIS doors differently now. Back in Classic Who, there were two sets of doors. The external doors that operated like any normal door, and the internal doors, these massive white slabs that were mechanically opened. How these two sets of doors related to each other was never really explored in the show, but it gives the visual impression of some kind of space between the TARDIS's outsides and insides. Nowadays, there's just the one set of doors that leads directly into the TARDIS's control room, because it allows for faster action. The Doctor couldn't just run out of the TARDIS originally, and it makes the whole "it's bigger on the inside" reveal play out much more smoothly. In any case, whatever this space between the doors is, that's where the monster is hiding and making its attacks against the TARDIS. Whatever it's doing, the TARDIS is freaking out. Portions of the console are getting electrified, most of the lights go out, there's slime everywhere, it's just bonkers. The Doctor tells Ace to stay in the control room and rides a bicycle deep into the TARDIS's innards to find a solution. But as if this day couldn't get any worse, there happens to be another time machine in the time vortex. A cruder, more amateur model being physically operated by a group of people known as the Cronauts, piloted by a 4-year-old child named Shaunzi. One of the operators, some jackass named Vale, scares the kid, causing him to lose focus, and their ship collides with the active TARDIS. There's a boom and a bang, and everything goes black. Ace awakens to find herself in a bizarre alien city, where it's always dusk, buildings of impossible geography rise on a horizon that never seems to stop, and rivers of liquid mercury segment the area into three distinct zones. The Cronauts are there as well, trying to figure out who they are and how they got there, their memories fading in and out. And then the creature shows up. The creature stood along the bank about 50 meters away, a massive leech that reared up, swaying to and fro as if it were hunting, a gnarled gray worm arching up from a single broad mollusk foot of its tail to a flattened cylinder head in whose crater rested a contorted mouth like a lamprey. Lines of rippling clawed fins ran the length of its aged and cracked body. Ace didn't dare move. The repulsive thing hissed again. Its head sank down to the ground with a squelch. Behind it, the foot and its tail rose in a curving arc until it assumed the position she had first seen. In this foot, there was also a slavering mouth. It wheezed with its effort, but it came steadily on, cartwheeling painfully, foot mouth over foot mouth, covering its path with a trail of stinking slime. This creepazoid calls itself the Process. It has a gang of insect-headed minions, and Vale has sworn allegiances to it, But you can't really blame him. The M.C. Escher planet doesn't really have much of a jobs market. The process is trying to find the Doctor. It claims the Doctor has stolen the future, whatever that might mean. And where is the Doctor? He's a phantom, a ghost, a faded, bizarre image flittering in and out of Ace's view. Sometimes his presence is rather surreal. The figure was turned away from her, oblivious of her clumsy arrival. But that was typical. A checked trousers and brown jacket were disheveled, and he somehow had his hat back. "Professor," she said from the ground, but she kept any relief or excitement in check. "I thought you were dead." He didn't move. Only the fingers on one hand tapped out the seconds against his trouser leg. Ace clambered to her feet and moved warily closer. "Doctor?" He turned towards her. Below his hat, his clean and undamaged hat, his face was a black reflective slab. A digital clock face with a green liquid crystal display that said 11:56. "No!" shouted Ace. A sudden single gust of air, a shock in this place, caught at the fog and it lifted like a curtain. The phantom went with it. So the two big questions here, what is this place and just who are the Chronauts? Well, this place is the TARDIS. More specifically, this is the TARDIS blown up and turned inside out. It's now bigger on the outside. This is what happens when an infinite amount of space that can be freely manipulated, crafted, and deleted, that has a very special relationship with the temporal, is allowed to run amok. The city is segmented into three time zones. Cross one of the Mercury rivers, and you'll find yourselves backwards or forwards in time, which means multiple versions of the same people are running around, crossing each other's time streams. There's even two versions of the process, a younger and an older one, and they don't get along, which, you know, I can relate to. If I had to work together with myself from 10 years ago, I'd end up kicking his ass. "Go to the doctor and get that checked, you dumb shit." And the Chronauts? Well, they're pioneers in time travel, the first time travelers of their race. A race that will eventually build their entire society around time travel. They're the first time travelers of Gallifrey, from the ancient history of the Time Lords. Cat's Cradle times Crucible is a Time Lord origin story. The Cartmel Masterplan has arrived. Marc Platt, not to be confused by the producer behind Wicked with the same name, was born in 1953 in London, and was a Doctor Who fan from the very beginning, catching the very first episode on November 23rd, 1963, and he never turned back. He eventually grew a conviction to write for the show. Not to write for anything else, he didn't want to become a great novelist, he just wanted to write for Doctor Who. And starting in the mid-70s, he sent pitch after unsolicited pitch to the BBC. One of the first he sent was a story called Fires of the Star Mind, which was about a sentient star trying to take over Gallifrey, and the Fourth Doctor, Sarah Jane Smith, and Harry Sullivan would travel to Gallifrey to try and stop it. The script editor at the time, Robert Holmes, actually got in touch with Platt to express how much he liked the script, but they couldn't use it, because at that exact same time, Holmes was writing The Deadly Assassin. The Deadly Assassin also had the Fourth Doctor going to Gallifrey to stop an evil plot, and would be the closest look at the Time Lords the series had had to date. A dark Manchurian Candidate-style political thriller played out by demigods. Marc Platt's Gallifrey and Robert Holmes' Gallifrey were incompatible, so Platt's story was rejected, but he was encouraged to continue submitting material. Platt came close again in the early 80s with a story called The Warmongers, a story set during the London Blitz, which would have been the first Doctor Who story set in World War II. He co-wrote it with Doctor Who Appreciation Society founder Jeremy Bentham, and got into some serious talks with the script editor at that time, Eric Sayward. But it didn't go anywhere. Shortly afterwards, Eric Sayward left, and Andrew Cartmel came in. Between Cartmel getting the script editor position, and the producers deciding to fire Colin Baker, Platt whipped up a fresh pitch called Cat's Cradle. The original Cat's Cradle storyline had featured the Sixth Doctor and Mel. The silver cat that appears in the book would have been the cat from the Sixth Doctor's lapel. That idea got a bit lost when I rewrote the story for Sylvester. It was always a nice idea, I thought, because the cat was supposed to be the spirit of the TARDIS. The idea that the cat was supposed to be the Doctor's lapel come to life makes me wonder what the story would have been like if Platt wrote it for the fifth Doctor. Would Tegan be getting chased around by a giant celery monster? Now, this version of the story didn't involve the Cronauts or the connections to ancient Gallifrey, but that desire to explore the history and culture of Gallifrey hadn't left Platt since writing Fires of the Star Mind. Cartmel had to reject the script. They didn't really have the budget for giant leech monsters. Remember the Mirka? Never again, never again. Still, Cartmel wanted Platt on the writing staff, so he invited him to a meeting along with another new writer, Ben Aronovich. The three of us hit it off immediately. We sat in his office discussing their ideas for the series. They were so fascinating and daring. Andrew and Ben had been working out about the true nature of the Doctor and the early days of Gallifrey. This was all part of their grand scheme to put the mystery back into Doctor Who. We wanted to knock the established mythos sideways. And thus, the Cartmel Masterplan was born. Man, what I'd give to be a fly on the wall during that meeting. That said, let's clear a few things up about the Masterplan. It was never going to happen on TV, not in that form. John Nathan Turner couldn't have been any less interested in that stuff. He didn't want to explore the Doctor as a character, he didn't want to explore his past. It didn't excite JNT in the least. Even if Doctor Who hadn't been cancelled and JNT left after season 26, things were already in motion that would have changed the show dramatically. Sylvester McCoy and Sophie Aldred were already planning on leaving the show, with Ace leaving midway through the theoretical season 27 and the Doctor regenerating at the end, with the role of the 8th Doctor most likely given to Richard Griffiths, aka Uncle Dursley from the Harry Potter movies. Now, I'm super curious what a Richard Griffiths Doctor would have been like. I really want to visit the alternate dimension where that happened, but I feel like they probably wouldn't have continued the Times Champion thing. It doesn't seem like it would fit him, but no, who knows? In any case, there weren't any plans to include the Cartmel Masterplan in season 27, and who knows how long Andrew Cartmel would have kept his position as script editor. No, the Cartmel Masterplan would just have been a legend among the fans, something to be discussed during Q&A panels at conventions and nowhere else. But the Virgin New Adventures offered an opportunity to finalize and expand on these ideas, a platform to present them, and in many ways, the Masterplan became a crucial blueprint for the entire series. Platt really led the charge in that. Andrew Cartmel and Ben Aronovich both contributed stories to the line, and they had their own tie-ins to the Masterplan, but Platt's books were capital M Masterplan books. A good chunk of this book includes scenes of ancient Gallifrey, before they became Lords of Time. We learn that the psychic powers of ancient Gallifreyans were so strong that they constantly projected their thoughts, so that to walk down a city street in Gallifrey would be to be bombarded by thousands of wandering thoughts. A lot of their technology is psychic-based, and a lot of their ambitions involve spreading their empire across the universe and fighting mystical creatures. On the screen, there were in-depth interviews with Prydonius and his crew, relating their quest into the blood-red mists of distant Thul, where they had overthrown the reign of a marauding sphinx. There were visual reports from the documentary team that had accompanied the voyage, but despite the euphoria, all the interviewers pressed home two questions. Was this the last of the epic space journeys? And did the new experiments into time travel number the days of the space voyager? Haklav Augustai Prydonius, the hero and seasoned interviewee, shook his mane of black hair and laughed out loud. I'm no lackey of Razlon and his neo-technologists. There'll be no substitute for the old order. To affirm this, he produced his greatest trophy, retrieved from the ruin of Thul. The severed head of the Sphinx itself. Preserved tempogenetically, it would be donated to the Academia Library for study. Perhaps, Prydonius added mockingly, it would be persuaded to divulge the answers of some of its riddles. The main conflict in these segments of the book concerns the Pythia, the matriarchal leader of Gallifrey, leading through powers of precognition, and his conflicts with Razalon, an engineer pushing towards a more technocratic society based around time travel technology developed by his compatriots, the scientist Omega, and an enigmatic figure known simply as the Other. Now, there are those who think we should never explore the origins of the Doctor or look into Time Lord history, as it might demystify elements that have tickled the imaginations of viewers for decades. And those worries aren't unjustified. It did happen to the Time Lords on some level, who were introduced as these stoic, hidden demigods. With every passing appearance, however, they lost a bit of the mystery, and by the time Trial of a Time Lord rolled out, they were bumbling, incompetent space bureaucrats. In order to bring some of the wonder and mystery back to Gallifrey, Russell T. Davies had to blow it up. Now, they're right, you can totally botch things when trying to develop and explore the backstory of the Time Lords, but I don't think it's impossible, and Marc Platt does a great job here. He injects the setting with a ton of new ideas, from the ways the loose psychic powers of the populace interact, to the glorifications of heroes, to, hey, let's go around space and fight cyclopses and medusas and shit. It is very far removed from the Gallifrey presented on television, but you can still see how we got from there to here. It helps that we're going back so far. We're pretty much Knights of the Old Republic-ing this thing. There's a lot of imagination on display, maybe not Time Worm Revelation amounts of imagination, but still carrying the creative momentum of that book. And that's very important because, frankly, the stuff involving the inside-out TARDIS and the process is kind of boring. You can kind of tell this part was adapted from a television script and involves a lot of stuff Classic Who would use to pad its runtime. Chases, captures, escapes, people arguing because no one will sit down and explain what's going on. The middle portion of this book really does spin its wheels for a time, though it is neat that Ace is progressing the story by herself. The Doctor is a no-show for most of the book, which is kind of unfathomable back then. You never saw that on televised Doctor Who, and as such this book got some criticisms about it, but then New Who came around and showed us that Doctor Light stories can be totally awesome. The Doctor does eventually show up, but he's lost his memories. This is just as much a plot extender as anything else, though the Doctor does give himself a cute nickname because of it. Take a message to your masters. Tell them that Willby is here. Tell them that Willby challenges them to control for the city, and inform them that I am Willby. Vale sneered and didn't wait to hear any more. He turned and vanished from the balcony. The other Fazzles were descending the steps to gather round the body of Regis. Ace didn't know whether to laugh or cry. Dr. Willby? She asked incredulously. The Doctor looked sternly at her and snapped back. Willby the Doctor. But he does eventually get his memories back, and we get an action-packed finale. The Cronauts return ancient Gallifrey, and Pythia, curses the Gallifreyan people with infertility. Because she's a sore loser like that. I mean, yeah, Razalon is a jerk in this book, but you ain't gotta bring your race to extinction over it. There is a solution, however. Looms! Yes, looms. Machines that take genetic material and pop out full-grown Time Lords. It's kinda like the clone machines from The Doctor's Daughter. People tend to either love looms or hate them. Those who love them do so because it's a wonderfully alien concept that helps separate the human-looking Time Lords from the human race. Those who hate them feel it's a pointless complication that's contradicted by the fact that the Doctor has grandchildren. I'm of a mind that it could have been a good idea, but it was never really taken advantage of. We'll be talking more about looms in the future. The TARDIS partially repairs itself. It folds itself back into proper dimensions, but it's still weak. Things are still broken. And that silver cat is still walking around. Turns out it's a personification of the TARDIS's banshee circuits, failsafes that use whatever nearby resources to keep the TARDIS alive. It's gonna take a lot of time to get the TARDIS back to 100%. I'd say, maybe two more books time. In many ways, this is a very impressive work. If Time Worm Revelation hadn't beat it by a few months, this would be the book to show just how far the Virgin New Adventures could go, how crazy Doctor Who could get when not restrained by a television budget or J&T. The concepts presented are imaginative and vividly described. One thing you can't say about Marc Platt is that he has a weak vocabulary. The TARDIS city, ancient Gallifrey, even the time-warped London streets of the beginning excite and engage. And while I personally don't think that the Cartmel Masterplan not playing on television was a huge loss, it's nice to see it presented in some kind of medium, give us some of the crazy ideas Platt, Cartmel, and Aronovich whipped up in that office 30 years ago. It's not perfect, however. The middle section really drags. There's not a lot of forward momentum. The process has a neat design, but as an antagonist, it's totally banal. A boring beastie that probably wouldn't have gained any power if the Chronauts weren't such pushovers. Besides from Vale and Shanzi, the Chronauts are pretty flat and uninteresting. They don't do much besides stand around like a deer in headlights. Ain't gonna lie, without the scenes in Ancient Gallifrey, I probably wouldn't have finished this book when I originally read it. Since that stuff wasn't in the original story pitch, Cat's Cradle probably would have made for some pretty boring television. I suppose my recommendation will depend on how much you care about the Cartmel Masterplan and exploring Ancient Gallifrey. I think it's really interesting, but not everybody does. Next time, the Doctor and Ace park their broken TARDIS in a desolate near future, where pollution has run amok and there's violence in the streets. What can turn things around? Heavy government reform? Massive structural overhaul? No, silly. Kids with superpowers. Duh.